From the studios of Staten Island Community Television, you're watching In the Bleachers, the TV show for the world's most passionate sports fans. Hello, everyone, and happy opening day, if you will. I'm Jaime Hixson.
And I'm Eric Rosen, and we're not at Citi Field right now.
Although we wish we were, especially after what happened earlier today.
Yep, the Mets took to their opening day, and as usual, 9 out of the last 12, including today, they won in resounding fashion, 6-0 in front of a sold-out home crowd.
Yeah. There's just something special about opening day of a baseball season. There's the look of the grass on the infield, the umpire yelling out play ball for that first time, the players taking the field. Lately, it's been the unveiling of the giant American flag on the field by members of the armed forces. And, of course, it's never complete without the singing of the national anthem. But in this case, opening day technically was yesterday because they had a triple header of games going on. They had Yankees, Rays, they had Diamondbacks and Giants, and then they ended it with a really nice ending to that Cubs-Cardinals game as the Cubs, believe it or not, opened defense of their World Series championship. Who saw anybody uttering those words? The Chicago Cubs opened defense of their world title.
But not only that, how about the St. Louis Cardinals last year missing the playoffs for the first time in 6 years?
Mm-hmm.
And then to start off the offseason, they poached from the Cubs, getting Dexter Fowler to help their shaky outfield. And Randall Grichuk, sometimes I can get his name wrong, in the eighth inning gets the game-ending RBI, actually in the ninth, the game-ending RBI single that brings in the winning run.
Mm-hmm.
4-3, they end up beating the Cubs. This team is really on the rise right now. Well, always the Cardinals are in the conversation for the NL Central, but I just heard earlier, actually yesterday, that Yadier Molina got a new contract extension that extends him to 2020. So the fans yesterday were chanting, Yadi, Yadi.
Yep.
They love him.
He's become a real iconic player for that franchise in the last 14 years. Now he's going to be signed until, I think, 2020 or 2021.
I'm really happy that they did that. It was a very smart business move on their part. He's been one of the remaining constants on this team through all the turnover that they've had.
Mm-hmm.
And all the different players that have come and gone. Yadier Molina has remained basically very loyal to his team. But getting Dexter Fowler is a very smart move.
Yeah.
He's a good leadoff guy. And, you know, it does help in a lot of ways for some of their other players to move into that third batting spot.
Mm-hmm.
As for the Cubs yesterday, John Lester had five really ineffective innings. But, there were times where things really just were not great for him. But Kyle Schwarber, though, for the Cubs, reached three times in his first game as the leadoff. So Schwarber being made the number one hitter, I think, is going to be very good for the Cubs. You know.
Yep. How do you see the Cubs going in their first season post-championship? Because when you think about it, they're not necessarily the favorites, although they are being looked at as someone to definitely be taken seriously now that they've won it all. But this is the year, this is the first time in over a century when they're really going to be the hunted.
Well, Javier Baez has got to have to get a lot more playing time this year. That's for sure. They're going to have to really do a good job figuring that out. Brett Anderson's got to have better health this year for that rotation. Other than having John Lester at the top of the rotation, I think the number five spot, that's going to be the most precarious to watch throughout the season for the Cubs. And as for Greg Holland, you know, right now being in their bullpen.
Yeah.
That's going to be interesting to watch that, too.
Other than that, there's also the issue of Jason
Hayward.
Actually,
Wade Davis, sorry.
Yeah. There's also the issue of Jason Hayward. He of the eight-year contract. Jason Hayward looked lost at the plate at times last season. So much so that he had a very minuscule batting average. But now He's in the second year of that 8-year deal, and now is the time for him to really, really step up his game at the plate. And last night, it was basically him doing an impersonation of what he was doing the majority of last season. I mean, he still brings a lot to the table. He's a great defensive outfielder, good throwing arm too, but at the plate, he's never really been that overpowering, productive hitter that he was touted to be when he first came up with the Braves.
What about how about Carlos Martinez, who pitched a wonderful game yesterday, got retired 12 straight people, 18 of 19, and going striking out 10, walking none in 7 1/3 innings. You know, the fact that he's made it to the top of the rotation for the Cardinals, that's really a great sign right there for them. And, you know, seeing some of the other players in this team. And how about the winning rally, Jose Martinez, with a pinch hit double against Mike Montgomery?
Yeah.
But he wasn't the only pitcher that was doing some damage yesterday. How about Madison Bumgarner with 3 RBIs, 2 home runs, first time ever that a pitcher has done that? And guess what happened? Their Mark Melancon blows the save opportunity, and they lose to the Arizona Diamondbacks. Everything that Matt the Bum did, and I say that with such positivity because he's nothing like the negative word of what a bum is. Bumgarner did all the work, and basically Melancon, one inning, screwed everything up. Couldn't get that third out.
And Melancon got a big contract with the Giants because their glaring weakness last year was the bullpen. And Melancon, in his first save opportunity, does not get the job done, but don't necessarily think of this as a sign of things to come, because Melancon has been a real proven closer in his time with the Nationals and the Pirates and elsewhere. He's really going to stabilize that bullpen. Don't forget. And they also got themselves another big pickup, getting Denard Span to play center field.
I don't. And believe me, the guy that they signed, Melancon, 90.7% of save chances he's converted in the past 4 years with a 1.80 ERA and 0.91. That's what they're paying the 4 years, $62 million for that. And yet he didn't deliver yesterday. Let's hope that he'll correct the mistakes that he made yesterday and be able to help this team in the long run. And they need healthy seasons from Joe Panik and Hunter Pence, you know. The fact is, they were 19th in the majors in runs per game, so that's got to improve right there. And the number 5 spot, like the Chicago Cubs, is another precarious position. Matt Cain right now is teetering.
Yeah.
This is the year where he either has to prove it, you know, crap or get off the pot, as they say. Because if he doesn't, you got Ty Black and Tyler Beede, one of those guys that could take over, that are waiting in that bullpen to take over his number 5 slot.
Yep.
So the Giants, really, if they want to contend against their hated rivals, the Dodgers, who, by the way, I think just finished their game. At the last time I looked, they were leading 12-1. It was a big titanic butt-kicking by the Dodgers. Clayton Kershaw, this year, you know, you talk about the NL West, you know, they are the class in the NL West. They came.
This could be a three. That's a two-team race right there between the Dodgers and the Giants. Some are picking the Giants to win the West this season, but I'm not too sure, especially with Kershaw still around. If he keeps his health 100%, look out. Not only that, but there's also the matter of some of the young players that the Dodgers have in their batting order.
How about the fact they got Logan Forsythe, Franklin Gutierrez? This was to help the issues they've had against left-handed pitchers. Last year, they went a paltry 214 against lefties. So in that sense, they got those two guys for that. And, you know, Jorge Urias, you know, he's actually not even playing with the team. He's at extended spring training right now, hoping he'll join the team sometime this year. And Rich Hill, Brandon McCarthy, Hyun Jin Ryu, you know, they combined last year for about 450 innings, but they really got to get behind Kershaw. And Kenta Maeda, I think, will have a breakout season. I think he could be an MVP candidate.
Yep.
On the rest of the NL West, you got the Padres, a terrible team that has mostly veteran pitchers on one-year deals and 3 upcoming players like Manuel Margot, Hunter Renfro, and Austin Hedges.
Yeah, and the team that beat the Giants yesterday, the Diamondbacks, they have a new manager, which is the one-time Yankee, Torey Lovullo, who's in his managerial debut, had a pretty decent start yesterday, beating the Giants walk-off style. But when you think about it, Arizona is a team that's got quite a few young players, and they're going to be someone to watch in the next couple of years.
You got A.J. Pollock, David Peralta. You know, They played a combined 60 games last year. They got to avoid injuries like the plague. Mm-hmm. You got Tajuan Walker, a former Mariners pitcher in their rotation, Robbie Ray and Brandon Drury. They got to have the breakout seasons. And, you know, you got Archie Bradley and Brandon Shipley. They got to really step up as well. This was a team that won a disappointing 69 wins and 93 losses. If they want to get anywhere in this division, they got to improve. As for the yeah, I mentioned the Giants and I mentioned the Dodgers. What about the Colorado Rockies?
Yeah, the Rockies are another team that's still trying to find themselves, mostly through a lot of young players. A
lot of injuries, though.
Yeah, a lot of injuries, too.
David Dahl, Ian Desmond, Tom Murphy, Chad Best, Chad Qualls, Chris Ross. That's several of your pitchers and hitters right there starting the year on the disabled list. But yet, what's intriguing is this trio they got of John Gray, Tyler Anderson, and Tyler Chatwood. These guys, you know, could really be a great 1-2-3 punch in that rotation if they go, if everything goes accordingly. And then you got these rookies coming up: Antonio Sensatella, mm-hmm. Kyle Freeland, and German Marquez. Mm-hmm. There's some up and comers right there. And then Greg Holland has got to have a bounce back year starting with this new team in this division. But going to the Central, we mentioned the Cubs and we mentioned the Cardinals. They're the two toughest teams that are going to be fighting for it. But what about the Reds? Are they going to be yet another season where they're in rebuild mode?
It could be, because they already started their rebuilding when they traded Brandon Phillips over the winter to the Braves. So now it's gotten to the point where they're going to have to go with the farm system.
Yeah, and you got not only that, how about Anthony DeSclafani and Homer Bailey, their two starting pitchers, both starting the year on the disabled list. Bailey with an elbow bone chip removal and DeSclafani with a sprained elbow. Mm-hmm. So that really hurts them right there. But you got these intriguing young arms in Amir Garrett, Rookie Davis, Robert Stevenson, and Cody Reed. And, yeah, Scott Feldman now is their starting pitcher.
Wow.
Does that name ring a bell?
Yeah, that definitely rings a bell. I think Scott Feldman pitched a no-hitter in Houston not too long ago, didn't he?
Yep, and he was with the Texas Rangers, too.
Mm-hmm.
The reason they went with him today is he's the most experienced opening day person they have in their rotation.
That's not really saying much.
But you got this speedy guy in the infield, Jose Peraza.
Mm-hmm.
He's going to be starting second base. Look what he did last year as a rookie. 324, 21 stolen bases in 72 games. This is going to be the year where he'll break out. The Brewers, on the other hand, right now, you look at this guy, Junior Guerra.
Mm-hmm.
He's their number one starter. You got Jonathan Villar, Keon Broxton.
Yep.
Then Guerra could be a trade chip. You know, he was a rookie at the age of 31.
Amazing.
31 years old, and he had a 2.81 ERA, a 1.13 whip, and 121 and two-thirds innings.
That's called paying dues right there. When you pay dues like that, through all those years toiling in the minor leagues, eventually you're going to get your shot. And that's also perseverance. This guy never gave up on his dream.
And you know what's going to probably be on the trade block? And I would not be shocked. Braun. I think his name is going to come up.
Ryan Braun? Yeah. I'm surprised he wasn't traded during the offseason. But then again, either his money or his baggage, his past baggage, might have scared some teams off.
I think mostly the contracts and what the teams were asking for him, too, scared a lot of people from trading for him. But you never know. I think his name could come up by the end of July. But you got these two prospects, Lewis Branson, Josh Hader. They're going to be the next bigs coming up. The Pirates last year didn't make the playoffs, ending three straight years of making the postseason. And it was a disappointing year for Andrew McCutchen.
Yeah.
Yet this team averaged 4.5 runs, and you got Josh Bell, who really had a great impact season at first base.
Mm-hmm.
But yet Jung Ho Kang still has some immigration issues, and he hasn't come back from South Korea.
That doesn't sound good at all.
So I'm hoping that he'll get that figured out. Mm-hmm. As for Gerrit Cole, he's really got to have an ace season. Ivan Nova's going to have a good season like he had the last 2 months of 2016.
Yeah. Let's see what he can do over the long haul, because over the long haul, he's been either on the disabled list or he has been a real frustrating kid to watch. And he's not a kid anymore. He's now in his early 30s.
Let's go now to the NL East. This is really going to be something right here. The Philadelphia Phillies, this is yet another rebuilding season. This is not going to be a quick fix. You got Jeremy Hellickson. You know, he was a good reclamation project a year ago. But now you got Clay Buchholz on the team, which I never thought I would say those words.
And also they made the trade to get Howie Kendrick to be the second baseman.
And they got Jared Eichhoff, Aaron Nola, and Vincent Velasquez. This is a nice young trio of pitchers that are going to take this team to the future.
Mm-hmm.
But they still had a paltry 3.77 runs per game, the worst in the majors last year. But they did get Howie and Michael Saunders, so they did make some additions. The Braves, they're opening their new place at SunTrust Park.
Yeah, they went all out to try and be competitive this season in the first year of their new stadium. And I've seen the stadium on television. It's a nice-looking stadium. It's a little bit further off from downtown Atlanta. I think it's in Gwinnett County, if I'm not mistaken. But they went all out to try and be competitive this year, and getting R.A. Dickey and Bartolo Colon, making the trade for Brandon Phillips. Jaime Garcia they also got to be a part of their pitching staff. So you put Brandon Phillips in there with guys like Freddie Freeman and Nolan Arenado. There's a potential to score a lot of runs this time. And the Braves had major problems hitting the ball last season. So there's a strong possibility they could approach maybe even 70 wins this year.
I think what was even worse than last year was their rotation. They went through 16 different starters in 2016. And they had the 28th ranked ERA at 4.87. So getting these veterans who are going to help a lot of the youngsters, especially where you got a guy like Freddie Freeman and you got Julio Teheran, maybe, you know, these guys can do that.
And Teheran got himself a contract extension, so it's looking more and more like he's going to be the de facto ace of that staff.
Oh, without a doubt. How about the Marlins, though, really adding to help their boost their bullpen with Junichi Tozawa and Brad Ziegler?
Yeah.
You know, that those were very smart moves on that part, but we need to see a full year of Giancarlo Stanton. He's in maybe the third year of that 13-year, $325 million contract. That's got to pay off. D. Gordon with 79 games, we got to see a full season, not any more of these suspensions.
I wonder if either side wants a mulligan on that 13-year contract. I'm thinking Giancarlo Stanton would want it more than the Marlins organization themselves, because he has been clamoring to play on a winning team for the longest time now. I don't even remember him playing one season where his Marlins have been over 500.
They were 79-82 last year, which is really sad. But you know what? As they say, you know, the Latin word tabula rasa, clean slate. Well, this could be a clean slate for the Miami Marlins this year, or it could be more the same. But getting Edison Volquez and Dan Straley, I think we're not too bad additions to their staff. overall, you know what? This could be a make-or-break year for the Marlins, and for, especially Stanton. As for the Mets, of course, you know, today they won their game. Gizelman actually did pitch, is in the bullpen.
Yeah, but now he's going to be taking over Noah Syndergaard's spot in the rotation in the Florida series over the weekend, because Syndergaard had a blister in his finger during his start today.
Which is really, that's troublesome right there, because he is our ace.
Yeah, and Syndergaard really pitched good baseball this afternoon. He had major velocity on his fastball, didn't really see that much trouble except for the one bases loaded situation that he had early in the day. But the Mets and the Nationals are a two-team Eastern Division race right now. Both of them are built to win immediately. Probably more so the Mets than the Nationals, because the Mets really are stacked in the batting order right now. Yoenis Cespedes got himself a brand new contract, and also you figure with David Wright once again being on the shelf because of his injuries, this time it's his shoulder, there's going to be a revolving door at third base. Could it be that maybe they'll have Jose Reyes and Wilmer Flores share the time at third? Or is it going to be Reyes by himself taking the time at third with Wright out?
This is why I wanted the Mets to go for Yunel Escobar. This would have been perfect for our third base issues.
And what would have been of David Wright, though? I mean, they couldn't do anything with him.
As much as I love David Wright, I think there's going to be a time where they're going to have to look inward themselves and realize, you know, a team ahead of contract, team ahead of, you know.
Well, there's a time for that, but at the same time,
I know he's been Wright, loyal.
Yeah, Wright's been a loyal guy, but at the same time, they have such a logjam at third base right now, even with Wright on the roster, that I'm not really sure that bringing somebody else in would have been such a good idea. It was probably best that they go in-house. And they had Reyes to be the third baseman, and he acquitted himself reasonably well today. But probably the big blow in today's game was Lucas Duda's bases loaded double. That was what really blew the game open in that seventh inning.
And thank God, and they ended up winning 6-0, I believe it was. Yep. And on top of that, just now they're 36-20 all time on opening days, which is really something. They've won 9 out of their last 12 openers. I'm happy for all the fans that got to attend, and they got some nice new food options too.
Yep.
A few foodies out there, including chicken parm sandwiches and cookie dough and all that stuff.
Yep.
But as for baseball, instead of food and all those peanuts and Cracker Jacks, I don't care if I ever get back. The Nationals basically made a move to get Adam Eaton, but yet in the process had to give up a lot of prospects.
Yeah.
So this could either hurt them or help them right now.
Yeah.
Going further. And as for spring training from Bryce Harper, yeah, he had 8 home runs, but let's see if he can translate that to the regular season. And Steven Strasburg and Tanner Roark are going to have to be a hell of a 1-2 punch for this team.
So true.
As for the American League, let's start with the West Coast, the Oakland Athletics.
I would say right now it would be down to either the Texas Rangers or maybe the Seattle Mariners to possibly take the American League West right now.
What about the Astros?
I'm a little concerned about their first base situation, though. And I'm also concerned about who the back end of that starting rotation is going to be after Dallas Braden.
You know, you still got you got Keuchel. And you got
Dallas Keuchel, rather. Why did I say Dallas Braden? It's Dallas Keuchel.
And you got Keuchel and you got McCullers. That's going to be your front line. And there are even rumors of them trying to go for Jose Quintana from the White Sox. Because, you know, Quintana's name is going to be flown around throughout the year, including up to the trade deadline.
Yeah.
But, you know, going back to the Astros, the fact that they made moves to get Beltran, to get Brian McCann to be in there, and Josh Reddick, that add some power right there. With Jose Altuve, with George Springer right there, you got some serious heat on this.
The
Astros
power is there, but again, I worry about the pitching staff. But Carlos Beltran is approaching his 40th birthday. Can he still be the productive player that we saw him as all those years past? Not only that, but what if Brian McCann? McCann's production has been rather suspect in the last few years. I mean, granted, he was a serviceable guy when he played for the Yankees for 3 years, but at the same time, his run production, first of all, is what I really worry about, because he was not a 100 run guy when he played for the Yankees. He was a good player, but not necessarily an overpowering run producer.
They're both DH guys.
Mm-hmm.
More Carlos than Brian. Brian is going to be he's not going to be your regular catcher, that's for sure. He's going to be brought in on some days here and there because he's not getting paid the kind of money that he was used to when he was with the Yankees and the Braves.
Mm-hmm.
So right there, we're going to see McCann, you know, in certain situations, and we're going to see, I think, Beltran a lot of DH situations too with this team. But he'll bring some power to the team. I think he's going to knock some homers at a Minute Maid. As for the Mariners this year, Jerry DePoto did some really smart things this year. But the fact is they do have 11 newcomers on their roster, 18 altogether on the 40-man roster. They were 6th in the majors last year with 4.74 runs. My favorite move was getting John Segura to add some pop to that lineup. Felix Hernandez, he's got to have an ace type season. James Paxton's got to have a breakout year. And then the additions of Giovanni Gallardo and Drew Smiley really could help with the third and fourth spots in that rotation right there. You know, the fact is, this is a team that has not made the playoffs in 15 years.
Yeah.
The longest active drought of any team in Major League Baseball. Could it finally end this year?
Could it end? Yes. Will it end? We're just going to have to see, because after making all of those changes, you would expect for some more run production to be taking place.
And then as for the Texas Rangers, you got the 1-2 pop in that rotation of Yu Darvish and Cole Hamels. I think that was the best move acquiring Hamels to pair with Darvish.
Mm-hmm.
But then they got Andrew Cash and Tyson Ross. Those were a little questionable moves, I'll be honest. But then you got Jeremy Jeffress, Matt Bush, Sam Dyson. Will they have a hell of a season at the late inning trio in the relief corps?
Who knows?
Then you got Joey Gallo and Jerickson Profar. They got to have a big breakout season, especially without Adrian Beltre, who's going to be on the disabled list with a calf strain. That could really be impactful right there. And the Angels this year.
The Angels are a mess. The Athletics are a major mess. The Angels have been such a disappointment. And isn't it kind of coincidental that all of this is taking place ever since Albert Pujols signed his contract with them?
But look what they did. They added Espinoza, Cameron Maben, Ben Revere, Jesse Chavez, Merrill Petit, Bud Norris. This is a team that had a .235 batting average at second base and a .620 OPS. And at left field, a .204 batting average. Those were huge issues for the Angels heading to the offseason. I think they somewhat addressed that situation. But they're still going to be a team that's going to struggle, I think, come the second half.
Yeah.
The Oakland A's, on the other hand, though, what's really scary is not having Sonny Gray in that rotation right now with that shoulder strain issue. The rest of the rotation is combined for 92 starts, most of which have come from Kendall Graveman and Sean Manea. But Ryan Healy, though, he's a heck of a rookie. You see what he did last year. And how about Chris Davis with 42 homers and 102 RBIs? Could he have the same season for 2017?
It's hard to duplicate those numbers, especially considering how this has become a league of where guys really do their scouting. They really do their homework nonstop to try and find strengths and weaknesses on certain hitters.
Now into the AL Central, the White Sox, a team that everybody's going to keep their eye on because this was a team that got that traded Chris Sale to the Red Sox, that traded Adam Eaton to the Nationals, and coming soon to a theater near you, Jose Quintana. Where he ends up, that remains to be seen. If I'm the Yankees, if I'm the Kansas City Royals, if I'm a team that or the Cleveland Indians or some team that needs a one-year rental that's going to get me further, or the New York Mets, let's just say, if things get really dire.
He's going to cost somebody a king's ransom. I'm going to tell you that right now. That's why I think it was wise of the Yankees to not offer the entire farm for Quintana the way the Red Sox basically offered their best prospect to get Chris Sale.
I know.
The only bright light in that is that the Red Sox probably have the best rotation in the East. But as far as the Central is concerned, with all of those prospects that they have, Chicago is going to be a team that's going to be really, really dangerous in the next 3 or 4 years.
Look at their AAA affiliate, the Charlotte Knights. Look at the players that are going to be coming up in the next years. Yoan Moncada, Lucas Giolito, Reynaldo Lopez, Carson Fulmer, Zach Birdie. Keep your eye on that team in Charlotte, folks, because they're coming to the majors at a theater near you.
And they might even lead Charlotte to a AAA championship this year.
As for the Minnesota Twins, talk about terrible. They had the second worst team ERA in baseball, 5.08 last year. They were 59-103. But yet, you got rookie Adalberto Mejia, who's coming up, who edged out Jose Berrios and Tyler Duffy for the number 5 spot in the rotation. They signed Craig Breslow and Matt Belisle for relief help, if you call that. Byron Buxton and Miguel Sano, this is, the third year for these two. They really got to have a breakout season.
Buxton's had some problems with injuries, and it's time that he produce over 162 games. Miguel Sano is a really intriguing kid. He has the potential to be a big star in that game, but Buxton is the guy that they're looking at right now.
And what about the Royals? This is actually the final. This is the window closing in on them. Because you look at all the players that are going to be hitting the market next year. Lorenzo Cain, Eric Hosmer, Mike Moustakas, Alcides Escobar. There's no way this team can afford all of them next year.
Well, let me put it this way. If the Royals are out of the race by July, don't be surprised if you see those names being mentioned in new addresses this summer.
Especially for future prospects. And believe me, there are some teams who will give a king's ransom for especially a guy like Lorenzo Cain, who you can put in the number one spot, who's a home run threat, can steal bases. Moustakas, he's pretty good in the outfield. Hosmer, these are some dangerous guys. And they have one of the weakest farm systems, so maybe that could bolster their farm if they do that.
Quite possibly.
The Tigers, on the other hand, I think they did the smart thing, taking Anibal Sanchez out of the rotation and putting him in the bullpen.
Yeah. And there were a lot of trade rumors involving Justin Verlander, but in the end, they decided, you know what? Verlander has been their ace for the longest. And in spite of the medical, the recent medical history that he's had, let's see how much longer they can go with him. And, of course, there was the major trade. What was the big deal that they wound up making during the off season?
Well, keeping Daniel Norris and Matt Boyd there. The fact that they were 24th in the league in reliever ERA with a 4.22. They got Joe Jimenez, who's going to come to them at some point. Let's hope. But for the Tigers altogether, I think this could be another year for them to at least be in the wild card race. Mm-hmm. But the team that we're all going to be looking at is the Indians, who made the biggest move, Edwin Encarnacion.
Yeah, stealing him away from the Blue Jays. Now they've got more pop in their batting order.
You got Michael Brantley, who's coming back this year. Yan Gomes, you know, with a full season of Andrew Miller as their closer. That's huge. And then you have Clevinger and Ryan Merritt, you know, down the stretch. Mm-hmm. But Jason Kipnis, I can't wait to see what he does this year with Brantley and all these guys. The Cleveland Indians could compete for another run.
Yep.
And the AL East, the Tampa Bay Rays yesterday with Chris Archer. He did his job getting through the game for the Yankees.
And last season was such a disappointment for Archer. He lost 19 games last year. Everybody wondered exactly what was wrong with this young man. But this time, he was able to dig deep a little bit, and he really kept the Yankees off balance in yesterday's game. Let's talk about yesterday's game a little bit more at length. While Chris Archer pitched beautifully, Masahiro Tanaka made a lot of Yankee fans shake their head.
7 earned runs, 2 2/3 innings, worst ever performance by a Yankee starter.
Yep.
On opening day.
And, of course, there was Logan Morrison and Evan Longoria adding home runs. But the real puzzle in this whole thing is Tanaka. Because, for one, this is the first game where he wound up working with Gary Sanchez, who was the starting catcher, and this is going to be a major issue for the pitching staff. Gary Sanchez, a guy who's now going into his first full season in the majors, is going to be the everyday catcher now. He's still a young guy. Is the pitching staff really going to be able to trust this young man on whatever pitch selection he's going to be showing them? Well, and we could already see that yesterday, Tanaka and Sanchez had major, major problems with communication. They couldn't agree on signs. There was major body language issues with Tanaka. He was walking around the mound. He was visibly frustrated. And it was obvious that Tanaka and Sanchez were having issues with pitch selection in yesterday's game. And it was painfully obvious that Tanaka had major problems with control, too. He could not control his fastball. He could not control his splitter whatsoever. And because of that, they were basically treating him like a punching bag for the first 2 2/3 innings.
I think this is the year where the Yankees are rebuilding yet again. They're looking towards the next 2 years in free agency where they can pick up some major players, especially the names I mentioned with the Kansas City Royals.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be shocked the Yankees or Brian Cashman put their names in the hat next year for those guys.
Well, you never know. Although at this rate, the Yankees are probably all in with these youngsters, and it's not just Sanchez either.
Aaron
Judge is there. Also, Greg Bird, who's the everyday first baseman now. And, of course, there's the issue of
the rotation is
the starting rotation. Sabathia, Tanaka, and Michael Pineda are going to be the top three.
And then you got Luis Severino.
Luis Severino is going to be the fourth starter, and Severino was dreadful. He looked lost as a starting pitcher last year. Did much better coming out of the bullpen. So you have to wonder, was it just as simple as having a spring training where Luis Severino could probably right himself in going between the bullpen and the starting rotation?
I think he's more suited for the bullpen than he is a rotation pitcher, honestly. If I'm the Yankees, I think they may make the move to get Quintana. I know it would mean having to give up some prospects, but something tells me Brian Cashman is going to pull the magician's act of all time and get Quintana to this rotation. And
of course, the Yankees wound up bringing back Aroldi Chapman to be the closer, and you figure with him and Dylan Betances, they're going to be a 1-2 combo that's going to be close to unbeatable.
You would think, but if they can even get to them, if they can't win these games, what good is it with these guys?
Yep.
Really?
And then there's the back end of the rotation, which involves Chasen Shreve and Jonathan Holder and Ben Heller and Brian Mitchell. Right now, the Yankees are going with pitching to try and win them games, yet it's pitching that has become a question mark for them. Because you look at their batting order, you've got two youngsters on the right side of the field. You got Greg Bird at first and Aaron Judge as your right fielder. Other than that, you've got veterans, some of whom are still young guys, like Starlin Castro and Didi Gregorius on the middle of the infield, although Gregorius is going to miss the first month of the season because of his shoulder, meaning Ronald Torreyes is going to be the shortstop for the first month. And then there's Chase Headley, who still has not been the great, great answer for the Yankees at third base. And, of course, there's Brett Gardner, whose production's been going down in left field. Jacoby Ellsbury, who's been very, very brittle in and out of the lineup. Excuse me. He's going to be the center fielder. And then you have Sanchez, the everyday catcher now. And then you have Matt Holliday as your designated hitter. I thought that was the most brilliant signing that Brian Cashman could have done. He gives them a lot of pop in the batting order.
And on a one-year deal, nonetheless, too, to see, because this is a redemption year for him.
And also getting Chris Carter to come off the bench, a guy who hit 41 home runs last year but barely got over the Mendoza line.
What about the rest of the AL East, too? You look at the Baltimore Orioles last year. This was a team that led the majors with 253 home runs. Mm-hmm. They have a hell of a relief corps with Zach Britton, Brad Bach, and Darren O'Day, and led the majors third in the majors, first in the American League with a 3.40 ERA, but yet they have the crappiest rotation, just as bad as the Yankees. And they didn't even address this issue in the offseason the Yankees, too. Chris Tillman's got shoulder bursitis. Miley's got a respiratory infection. Yet you got Kevin Gausman, Dylan Bundy, and Ubaldo Jimenez as your starting three. That scares me a bit. And they let Matt Wieters go. So let's see how this works out for them. As for the Toronto Blue Jays, losing Edwin Encarnacion, it was no choice because he was asking for over $150 million, and they weren't willing to give that.
And it wasn't just Edwin Encarnacion either. It was R.A. Dickey. It was Mark Burley, who retired. So now they're going to go with a much younger staff, and it's looking more and more like everything is going to fall on the shoulders of Jose Bautista and maybe Josh Donaldson in the batting order.
Well, you also have to think about, too, in this rotation, you got Marcus Stroman and J.A. Happ, of all people. J.A. Happ, this guy's been bounced around with the with the Phillies when he started his career out, bounced around so many teams, and yet he's found a home with the Toronto Blue Jays. And you have, of course, Francisco Liriano.
Yep, and Stroman pitched so well for the United States in the World Cup when the United States won the World Cup.
Had a choice between us and Puerto Rico and chose to play for the United States. Thank you for choosing us, Marcus. Mm-hmm. I know that probably was a very tough decision on your part, but you know, we commend you that you play for us. But if you would have played for Puerto Rico, well, we would have been understanding of that too. But nonetheless, he led us to an 8-0 win, very solid pitching. And Lugo had a terrible game in that respect.
Yeah.
But, you know, as for the Blue Jays themselves, you know,
Toronto's going to be a lot weaker in their rotation, but I still think that they have enough in their batting order, even with Encarnacion gone, to be a factor in the American League East race this year. But right now, the team to watch is the Red Sox, and they are loaded in the pitching staff, getting Chris Sale, also having the reigning Cy Young Award winner, Rick Porcello.
Yeah, who had 22 wins and 4 losses on the year. That was really something. This was a former Detroit Tigers pitcher.
Also David Price, who won 18 games, but was really, really battered and had to labor to get those 18 wins. But right now,
but Price is on the DL though.
Yeah, Price is on the disabled list, and that's going to really hold them back for the first month of the season. But if and when he does return, the Red Sox have the best trio in the Eastern Division.
And this guy Andrew Benintendi,
mm-hmm.
Watch him. This I can't wait to see this guy have a full season. And Paul Sandoval. Kung Fu Panda, as they call him, he better find his...
And also, this is the first year post-David Ortiz, so...
And David Ross,
so...
Actually, no, he was with the Cubs, sorry.
Mm-hmm. This is the first year without David Ortiz, so let's see how the Red Sox do San Big Papi.
And David Ross actually on Dancing with the Stars still tonight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what first ever MLB player to be on that show.
Yep.
And how about, last night, this past weekend, we had UConn having their 111-game win streak snapped by Mississippi State in overtime.
In the women's Final Four. And South Carolina won the other semifinal of the women's Final Four. And then last night... South Carolina, who, by the way, is coached by a Hall of Famer, Dawn Staley, won the first national championship, the first NCAA national championship in basketball, men or women, in that school's history.
And it was her first national title because look at all the years of not reaching that milestone when she was a player at Virginia. Mm-hmm. But to be able to help South Carolina realize her dream and the Gamecocks' dream, that entire school is really indebted to her in Columbus, in Columbia. And right now, things are really that takes the taste out of their mouths from the unfortunate loss that the men had against Gonzaga.
It's a proud time to be a Gamecock in the Columbia area because the basketball program, the men and the women, really, really has had a renaissance.
And in the Final Four in the men's, and congratulations to South Carolina. I'm sorry for Gino Auriemma and UConn, but I got to give it up to Gino. He was very gracious in defeat as he was in victory. So big ups to Storrs U Connecticut. I think there's more to come from them.
Mm-hmm.
As for the men, of course, the Gonzaga Bulldogs took on the South Carolina Gamecocks, had a 15-point lead in the second half.
Mm-hmm.
And look what South Carolina did. They went on a 15-0 run to catch up to them.
Yep.
They were down 75-72 with about 12.7 seconds left. Williams-Goss misses a shot. South Carolina gets the rebound. They call timeout. Down by three. South Carolina passes the ball. Gonzaga fouled Sendarius Stormwell, the leading scorer who averaged around 25.4 points a game for the Gamecocks. So he could shoot with about 3.5 seconds left. Makes the first free throw. Misses the second on purpose so his teams could get the offensive board. Unfortunately, Killian Tilly gets the rebound for Gonzaga. Fouled. Made two free throws. They ended up losing 77-73.
Mm-hmm.
And that was your ball game right there. So the Gamecocks, the fact they made it as far as they did, beating the likes of Duke, beating Marquette, a team that was better at three-point shooting, the fact that they defeated Baylor and Florida in the second week, they did all these impossible things for a team that was 299th in offensive efficiency.
Not bad. This is a real renaissance time for South Carolina basketball because before this year, and to a lesser extent last year, the only time that South Carolina basketball really, really meant anything was when Frank McGuire was the head coach in the 60s and 70s. And in fact, it was Frank McGuire that took them to their very first NCAA tournament, 1971. And he opened a pipeline of ball players to make their way from his hometown here in the New York area to the Carolinas.
And, of course, the most famous still is Alex English, but, went to the Denver Nuggets. But overall, this year for the Gamecocks was very successful. The fact that they made it as far, and this will be a good recruiting tool for their head coach, to get players to want to come to South Carolina. Because he can say, well, folks, guess what? We made it to the Final Four. Why are you always going to choose Duke or Kansas? I get it that, you'll get to the NBA with them or Kentucky, but you could have another experience like that with me at South Carolina.
And he did such a great job using that sales job when he recruited the home state product, Sendarius Thornwell, 4 years ago. Now he's going to be going to the next level. it's going to be tough for South Carolina not having their leading scorer back next season. But at the same time, South Carolina is in really good hands with Martin as the coach. He's really, really busted his tail to bring that program back to prominence.
And the women also are going to be returning most of their players. So mm-hmm. the Gamecocks look very good for the foreseeable future mm-hmm. in both the men's and women's basketball program. As for the other Final Four game, North Carolina, Oregon. And it came down to the final offensive board of the game made by Mr. Kennedy Meeks, who had 25 points, 14 rebounds, 8 of which were on the offensive boards, and one of them being the last one, 11 of 13, that he shot from the field.
Two chances for Oregon to try and box out and get a rebound to set up for a potential game-winning shot. And each time, Carolina does a better job of getting to the ball. That just goes to show you what happens when you've got big bodies underneath, especially a guy like Kennedy Meeks, a hometown product from Charlotte, who's had a very, very serviceable college career for them.
Here's the thing. They're down 77-74. Why didn't Oregon go for the three-pointer to tie the game up, instead go for the
layup? I personally
didn't
have a problem with it because...
With 7 seconds left, though, when you should have gone for the three, especially against a team like North Carolina, that you don't want to shoot up against inside.
Mm-hmm.
You want to get them in the perimeter.
Not only that, but Oregon really was not set up properly to go for a potential game-tying three. I didn't really have a problem with them getting two in that stage. And they did exactly what they were supposed to do, which was get a quick basket and foul on the inbounds. It just so happened that the ball bounced North Carolina's way. Speaking of which, here's something that you may not have known about North Carolina. This is going back 10 years. In this era of one-and-done ball players, in the last 10 years, North Carolina has not had one single one-and-done guy. It's only been guys lasting 2, 3, or maybe all 4 years in Chapel Hill. That just goes to show you how, one, they have a really great chemistry atmosphere. Yeah. They have a great family atmosphere in Chapel Hill. Two, Roy Williams is a hell of a coach.
The power of Roy Williams right there. He has that effect on the players, like a Krzyzewski, you know, or Jim Boeheim. There are certain coaches, or even the late John Wooden, if you will, mm-hmm. who led UCLA to 10 national titles.
Yep.
You know, there are certain coaches that have that aura and mystique in college basketball, in any sport, really, if you think about
mm-hmm.
it. But Roy Williams, yeah, he does have that family atmosphere. You know, he's always there for his players, you know, no
yep.
matter what time of the day.
And he gets that from Dean Smith, because Dean Smith always, always checked up on his former players, even years after their retirement. He would call them up and say, hello, how you doing? Is there anything that I can do for you? Do you need anything? That's just the kind of guy he was.
That's just courtesy. That's amazing right there. That's really caring about your players. That's really throwing yourself into the team.
Mm-hmm. And in the segregated South, when Dean Smith first took over for Frank McGuire at Carolina, Dean Smith was the one guy who wound up integrating the program at Carolina.
And that was way before Texas Western did that.
Long before Texas Western.
Yeah, because I remember that movie Glory, of course, one
yep.
of my favorite.
Texas Western, of course, had the first all-black starting five in a national championship game when they beat Kentucky.
And later they became UTEP.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, Kennedy Meeks, though, he joined an exclusive list. He had 25 points and 14 boards. You know how many people have done that in the past 40 years in the Final Four? Only four people. Him, Ed O'Banion, Larry Bird, and Carmelo Anthony, and actually Danny Manning.
Yep.
It's actually five people right there. That's not outstanding, that company right there, to join them and be able to accomplish that. So tonight, you got North Carolina and Gonzaga.
Yeah.
This is going to be...
This is going to be a really intriguing matchup, because when you think about it, these teams are kind of sort of mirror images of each other, because each has this really big, husky guy playing the middle who can clear a lot of space to get rebounds.
Karnowski for the...
For Gonzaga.
Who unfortunately got his eye swiped.
Yeah.
And he was out the last 5 minutes in the game against South Carolina. Thankfully, he was able to come back in the
mm-hmm.
game. But you also got another 7-footer in Zach Collins, who could be a lottery pick
mm-hmm.
for the Gonzaga Bulldogs. As for North Carolina, you got Kennedy Meeks, who's a really good player. You got Justin Jackson.
Kennedy Meeks, Justin Jackson, and a whole slew of really good role players that Carolina has.
But here's the for Gonzaga. This was a team that was number one in the country in defensive efficiency. Mm-hmm. But yet their issue was in defensive turnovers.
Yeah.
That's the problem. They're a bad defensive turnover team, but they're great in overall defense. North Carolina, they're number one on the offensive board.
Mm-hmm.
Really, if you look, because that's what they do. They kill you in the offensive board inside, just like they did in against Oregon. And they're also, but they're terrible at the charity stripe. In the tournament, they've shot 70.1% mm-hmm. at the free throw line. That's not going to cut it against Gonzaga team.
No, not even.
As for, if Gonzaga wants to win, they got to take away North Carolina's ability on the offensive glass.
Yeah.
They really got to out-rebound mm-hmm. North Carolina. Otherwise, that you're playing right into their hands if mm-hmm. you don't if you allow that to happen. They because in the last four games, they've given up at least 12 offensive rebounds, Gonzaga, 20 of which were against Press Virginia.
Yeah.
You know, as for North Carolina, if they want to win, do not let Gonzaga play a game of pace. Make it into a sprint race.
Yeah.
Because North Carolina is a lot faster, especially if you tire guys like Karnowski and mm-hmm. Collins out.
Mm-hmm.
Then that plays in North, and North Carolina can get Gonzaga in that respect. Mm-hmm. If I had to pick who's going to win this game, folks, I'm going with the West Coast Conference champion, Gonzaga Bulldogs, 37-1, number one in the West region, a team since mid-January has been one of the best teams in college basketball. And the fact, the road that they got here, especially barely getting out of the game against West Virginia, playing very hard and trying to stop an offensive juggernaut game from South Carolina.
Think of how far that program has come in the last two decades.
Yeah.
They went from being just known as the school where John Stockton graduated from to 19 consecutive NCAA tournaments.
No Final Fours, though,
yep.
until this year.
Yep. They made their Final Four debut, and now they're 40 minutes away from winning a title. If they win this title, this would really set a standard for a lot of the
not just
mid-major schools, but mid-major conferences. The West Coast Conference would be on the map.
Oh, with Spokane, Washington, you know.
The city of Spokane, Washington has long been on the map.
No, but for this.
And not just literally either.
Well, they're also, they have good wrestling programs too, especially if you want to be like a Greco-Roman wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
Spokane, that area, very good up there for that. But as for, you know, Gonzaga itself, this is going to be a great recruitment tool.
Yeah.
For a lot of future players, especially they have a great pipeline to Poland and mm-hmm. In Eastern Europe.
Yeah.
They always get a lot of the big players, especially President Karnowski, who, by the way, last year had back issues.
Yep.
Was rehabbing. And now he's 40 minutes away from winning a national title.
And they've done so well, not just recruiting in Europe, but they've gone as far away as Australia. They've gone north of the border to Canada. The international flavor that they've had in the past has really opened up a lot of opportunities for young players across the globe.
As for North Carolina, if they win, this will be the sixth national title overall for North Carolina's history.
And they've already extended their own NCAA record with 20 Final Four appearances.
Which is the most. And then the fact that Roy Williams himself is on the list, you know, with John Wooden and some of the other great coaches, you know, in the history of this game right here.
And he's already in the Hall of Fame. He's done so much in his career. He's taken Kansas to the Final Four. He's taken his home state school, North Carolina, to the Final Four. He's learned under an iconic man, Dean Smith. He could probably retire now and be happy, but he's just having so much fun coaching this group of kids that he's not going to go anywhere anytime soon.
Watch tonight, 9:20, CBS. We'll see who wins. I'm going Gonzaga. Who are you going with?
I like North Carolina in this one. I think they've got the better go-to guy, and I think they've got the better guy in the middle. And there's also some other news to be made in the college circuit. A familiar face to Knick fans is going to be a head coach, and it's none other than Patrick Ewing. He finally got that big break because he is going to be the big man, literally, on campus because he's returning to Georgetown to be their head coach.
Which, honestly, they needed some familiarity, and they need somebody to bring back the luster of the 80s. But I don't think we're going to see the Georgetown that was known for their physicality, if you will.
I'll tell you what. He's going to spearhead recruiting like there's no tomorrow. Just like John Thompson recruited some of the greatest big men like Patrick and Alonzo Mourning and Dikembe Mutombo, Patrick has the potential to bring some really, really great prospects to D.C. And one other thing, speaking of the Big East, just found out that two guys from St. John's are going to be transferring out. Darian Williams, who is going to graduate, but is going to go elsewhere to be a grad transfer. And also Malik Ellison, who's Purvis Ellison's son. He's going to be leaving after 2 years.
It's going to be sad. But let's go into the biggest event that took place last night, WrestleMania 33, Orlando, Florida. 13 matches took place. We had the first three in the kickoff show. Neville beating Austin Aries for the Cruiserweight Championship, keeping his title with the Red Arrow. Mojo Rawley winning the Andre the Giant Memorial.
Thanks to some assistance from one Rob Gronkowski, which I thought was hysterical. I did not see the entire card, but I saw on WWE's YouTube page that they had bits and pieces of last night's matches. Seeing Rob Gronkowski act the way he did was absolutely hysterical. He would be a perfect character for that business.
If he, after the NFL, look at Steve McMichael and some other former players, like Baron Corbin. Speaking of which, Baron Corbin, a former Washington Redskins player, was in the Intercontinental title match against Dean Ambrose. Lost, of course, because Dean Ambrose did the Dirty Deeds move. Mm-hmm. And then the first match of the night, one of the best matches to start the show, AJ Styles, Shane McMahon. Shane, you know what? He may not look like a fighter, but he really showed that he's got some spirit. He ended up losing to the Phenomenal Forearm. AJ Styles won. The U.S. Championship, Kevin Owens beating Chris Jericho. Think about that. Two Canadians fighting for the U.S. title. That's just ironic. And Kevin Owens wins with the pop-up powerbomb. New champion. Fatal 4-Way for the Raw Women's Championship. Bayley defeated Charlotte Flair, Sasha Banks, and Nia Jax to retain her title.
You know, I saw bits and pieces of that match. I'd never realized how husky Nia Jax is as far as body type is concerned. She is a beast.
But she's got power, and she comes from the NY family.
I would think so, the way she's built.
And then you had the Fatal 4-Way for the ladder match for the Tag Team Championship before the match began.
And the best part about this whole thing, the Hardy Boys. Of all tag teams, the Hardy Boys returned to WWE. I was flabbergasted when I saw that.
And what I was just doing was Jeff Hardy's thing that he does when he comes in the ring. But the both of them were really just amazing. We don't have too much time to get into what happened in their past, but believe me, on next week's show, we'll delve more into their past. But they defeated Gallows Anderson, Cesaro Sheamus, Enzo and Big Cass, and then the new tag team champions.
Great to see them back again. Great to see them working again. It was a blast from the past.
Perfect.
Seeing those guys.
And then the mixed tag team match. John Cena and Nikki Bella, of course, beat the Miz and Maryse. It was a so-so match, but at the end of the match, the best part happened. John Cena broke out of character, got on one knee with a Tiffany diamond ring, proposed to Nikki Bella by her real name, and now the two of them are engaged and will be married. So congratulations to the newly engaged couple.
Yep.
Seth Rollins, of course, defeats Triple H with his own move, the Pedigree. It was one of the best matches of the night. Randy Orton beats Bray Wyatt to win his 13th championship with the RKO. My mom is probably was so happy. She loves Randy. The Universal title, Goldberg, unfortunately, it came to an end. He lost to Brock Lesnar due to the F5. Now Brock no longer is winless against Goldberg. He got his first win.
Well, it was bound to happen, to be honest with you.
13 WrestleManias later. And then the women's six-pack challenge for the WWE SmackDown Women's Championship. Naomi, the woman from Orlando, Florida, wins the title for the second time, beating Alexa Bliss, Carmella, Natalya, Becky Lynch, and Mickie James. You know, that's a name from the past right there.
Wow. I mean, I was stunned to see Mickie James, first off, because she was actually in semi-retirement for a while.
And doing some country music. And then the last match of the evening, Roman Reigns for the Spear, The Undertaker, for the third time, and finally got the 1-2-3 and a huge victory for his career.
And probably a humongous chorus of boos to go along with it.
But which honestly is unfounded because the guy is a tremendous talent, and I wish the fans would stop hating on him. But it was also symbolic for The Undertaker stood up, took off his hat, his jacket, his gloves, laid in the middle of the ring, signifying that it's the end of the road.
Really?
For the dead man.
Okay, this I have to see. Well, with that said, with about 20 seconds left, I'm going to sign you out. So, Eric, take us on home.
We got the Masters coming up this week. Brad Keselowski winning at Martinsville and TCU winning the NIT championship against Georgia Tech. So, folks, we'll see you next week on In the Bleachers. I'm Eric Rosen for Jaime Hixson, good people at CTV. Good night, and God bless and love you guys. Bye.